Друзі, ласкаво просимо Вайзон. Сьогодні фонд «Ізоляція» має приємність вітати тут Тома Скіпа, британського фотографа з Лондона, який зараз перебуває на резиденції в ізоляції.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are happy to welcome you at the iZone Creative Community, and on behalf of Isolatia, we are delighted to have Tom Skipp with us, a photographer from based in London, who is currently on residency at Isolatia. Прошу привітати Тома. І перш ніж я передам слово йому, я хочу запитати, чи є хтось у залі, кому потрібен переклад з англійської мови? Том говоритиме англійською. Прошу підняти руку, якщо вам потрібен переклад з англійської на українську. Нікого. So apparently there is nobody who will need the translation. Якщо ж якісь виникають проблеми, просто скажіть, я буду тут у залі і я зможу вам допомогти. So, well, I give the floor to you.
Maybe if there's anything that you don't understand, then you can stop and then we can translate.
Sure.
But most things are going to be on the screen behind me, so you'll be visually stimulated by by that. As I think you said, my name's Tom Skipp. I'm from London. In the United Kingdom, the soon-to-be former member of the European Union. I'd like to say thank you to Isolatia for hosting me during my residency, and especially to Lena, who's helped me basically every day for silly little requests from which pub to go to, which food to eat. In approaching this talk, I'd like to talk about... we'll do a few slides. Firstly, I find it... Sorry. Firstly, I find it slightly difficult to talk about myself as an artist, with context of being an artist. Probably what I do now is more sort of documentary photography, but most of it is self-initiated documentary photography, so it's projects that I feel passionate about, that I go to places to carry out projects that mean something to me. So this is kind of an ironic slide about being an artist, so I'm not really sure if I am or not. So, yeah, and talk. So as I said, I'd like to start by talking about context. To give you a context of where I come from and maybe a rationale for what I do. I'm taking this approach because I find things in Ukraine very different from the UK, not just language, also Cyrillic is particularly difficult for me to understand, and maybe a post-communist environment. So this is me when I was younger, obviously, and I was born to John and Kate Skipp, so this is my mother and father. And also I've got a sister called Amy Skipp. My father was a teacher and a keen amateur photographer who developed his own black and white prints and was also a pottery lecturer. My father's speciality as a teacher was working with children with developmental needs and behavioural problems. And my mother worked in the National Health Service until she's just about to retire now. My parents divorced when I was 18, and now I'm 39, so I've lived more with my parents being divorced than being together. I was raised partly in Milton Keynes, which is a strange thing called a new town, which alleviated the problem of London's overcrowding. So it was built with very heady aspirations and kind of idealist utopian dreams. It was very concrete and very straight line roads. It's not typical for the United Kingdom. That's where it is in the United Kingdom, to give you some context. And then my family moved to Lincolnshire for my father, for his teaching job. Lincolnshire is a very flat farming land, almost boring, with not much to do as a child or teenager. Lincolnshire is culturally not very diverse, so it's white, predominantly white English people, until the last 20 years when farmers started to get foreign workers, mostly from East Europe, to work in factories and on the farms. I attended, so that's where Lincolnshire is, I attended a grammar school, which is something that you take an exam at the age of 11 to get to. And it was an all-boys grammar school, which is kind of, I don't know if that's strange for here or not. On leaving school, I went to an art college and I did a foundation course in art and design. So that's where you can try several different things and see what you'd prefer to do in the future. So you can do fine art, illustration, pottery, illustration. I thought that I wanted to use a computer and I thought that I wanted to be employable. So I chose graphic design as my specialist subject. At that time in Lincolnshire, my next door neighbour was working for a man called Peter Saville. Now, Peter Saville designed Joy Division Unknown Pleasures, which you probably have seen on t-shirts around. It's an iconic record sleeve. Peter is a renowned art director and graphic designer. So as I've just said, he designed the Joy Division cover. When I was about 18, 19, I visited Peter's studio in Mayfair in London. It's the richest part of town, and I was kind of wowed by his plush lifestyle and the fact that he didn't get out of bed until 2 in the afternoon. And when he did, he was wearing a silk robe, he was smoking French cigarettes, and there was female models kind of flouncing around the place. So at that point, I decided that graphic design was definitely for me, and in the music industry specifically. So at the end of my foundation course, my mother and father were separating. So the foundation on which my life had been built, the stability and everything, kind of was pulled from under me. I believe this to be a very important part of who I am, because I had to totally rebuild. And I think at that point I was quite cocky, kind of teenager. So that really changed me. As I said, I chose to study graphic design at university. So after the foundation course, you do 1 year of foundation, then you go and do 3 years studying graphic design or art or pottery. So I chose to go to Manchester. Now, Manchester is a very difficult, different place to London. So London is culturally diverse. It's quite expensive to live there, but Manchester is pretty cheap. So these houses are not, they're pretty typical of Manchester. And these are the local people that you might meet on the street. So I chose, locals would actually target students as like easy prey, so they steal from students. I once saw a child shoot a firework at a bus through a drain pipe. So it was quite a sort of interesting time for university. And I gained a sense of discovery that I could produce any work that I wanted. So that's where Manchester is. So it's in the north of England, which is totally different to London. So this describes what Manchester is like at the time where I was there. So you've got Oasis and a really lively music scene. You could be in bars and meet all the sort of people that you need to meet in the centre of the city. So it felt quite a controllable city, but also music, football and music are kind of linked. And there's a thing called a scally, which is basically that person there. He's a scally. So where do I go next? So during my first year of university, there was a guy called Peter Saville, who I've mentioned, who was the external assessor. And what that means is they come in during your final project and they look at your work and they say, yes, this person's good. He could get a top mark or get a low mark. That person changed to a guy called Vaughan Oliver. Now, Vaughan Oliver designed all of the graphic output for a music label called 4AD. So he designed things called for the Pixies and for Dead Can Dance and various sort of indie bands. And it was during my time at Salford that I was given a placement with Vaughan, which made me which made all my other students quite jealous and made me even more unpopular than I already was. So I went to work with Vaughan, and it was a pretty eye-opening experience. We'd go for lunch at around 12, and we'd probably drink until like 2 or 3 in the afternoon, and then we'd go back to the studio. And I wondered when the work was going to start. It never really started. So one time I arrived at Vaughan's at sort of 10 o'clock in the morning on a Monday, and the first job was to go across the road to get some vodka and some Red Bull and some ice. So that was my early experiences of working. So then when I finished university, I moved to London. This was actually taken in Kharkiv in the Gazprom building in the language school. I was in Kharkiv recently taking photographs of architecture. So this is at the language school in Kharkiv. This is probably people's preconception of what London looks like. So you've got some Beefeaters. So that's kind of where my study finishes, and then I start working. So I was lucky enough to be offered a job with Peter and Vaughan at the same time. So I kind of worked that by working 2 days with one, 3 days with the other. So that's how my working life started. So that's the context from which I come from. I'm basically a privileged white man from Western Europe. But it's allowed me to make free decisions, which I think I probably take for granted. So let's start with some work. I knew that I'd got to move to London, so yeah, Vaughan and Peter. So I started working with Peter's studio, which gave me sort of amazing access to very high-end clients. He had a very small studio, about 4 or 5 of us. We had to service clients like EMI, for example. So my first job on leaving university at the age of 22 was to sort of head up the redesign of EMI's rebranding, which probably is an unrealistic view of what your working life is going to be as a young graphic designer in London. This was like a totally bizarre thing. As I mentioned, Peter's working behavior was kind of unconventional. So sometimes Peter wouldn't attend the meetings, he'd be late. So he's famously late. He's famously always in his silk robe. He's famously never attends meetings. It's all on Peter's agenda. So we'd have scheduled meetings with EMI and Peter wouldn't turn up. So as a 22-year-old graduate, I'd be sitting talking to the directors of EMI about the reason why we're changing the logo and not changing it very much, and you're paying us a lot of money for it. So as I said, it was a rather unrealistic view of the real world of graphic design day to day. Most designers purely service a client, so the client's needs. With Peter, they were paying him to do what Peter did, which is kind of unusual. He's sort of as close to being an artist designer as one can get. So for example, Adidas paid him to design some trainers just the way he wanted them to do, and Lacoste paid him to design a shirt. That's the sort of work he does. So where do we go from there? So rebranding of EMI is quite a serious project. And then I was kind of implemented as the sort of lead designer for music sleeves, which I was interested in. I thought it'd be creative. It allowed me access to musicians and gigs, and also I could take photographs and include photographs in my work. So this is a band called The Music, and we're working with 3D designers called Rachel Thomas and a photographer called Dan Tobin Smith. And again, I was sort of 23, 24 art directing this shoot, which is probably unheard of for that young person to be doing that. So let's go through a few more things. So, and this was also featured in Creative Review as like some good album sleeve work. Art directing shoots for a band called The Rakes. So with the Peter Studio being so small, you basically did everything yourself. So I design the 3D shapes, I make the 3D shapes, I put the lights in them, I art direct the photo shoot, I put the artwork together. I also worked at Vogue House, designing the launch issue for GQ Style. So as you can see, my design work has been pretty diverse. And then my relationship with Peter kind of ended. It became more fluid. So I went onto my own. I worked for myself, basically. So music clients would come to me instead of Peter because Peter no longer wanted to work. So this was for a band called Kasabian. I'm not sure whether they're known here, but they're like the biggest rock band in the UK. They're people that Oasis talk about as like they're the next Oasis. But so this was a pretty big project working with Sony Records, and I did everything for it. So this is a limited edition CD cover when people still made CDs. And then all the artwork for the album sleeves and the photo shoot. It was a pretty all-encompassing project. And at that point, music sleeve design still paid you enough money to live. So at that time, I was living in Paris with my girlfriend, and I was working with London and just creating these sleeves and then doing adverts for them, which would pay me enough money to live off. So it was a pretty privileged position. This cover also won an NME award. NME is a music used to be a music magazine in the UK, and it's like quite a prestigious thing. So this won an NME award for the best album sleeve design. But just to describe how the music industry works, I wasn't invited to the party that celebrated that award. So although you talk to the musicians, you're very much a service for those people. So where do we go now? So as you can see, they used it on stage, they used it in posters. I think this is where my design was at its best. So I was like scanning things in, typing things out on the typewriter, taking photographs, doing typography. So following this, I was asked to do Mumford & Sons logo. I don't know whether you know of those people here. They're kind of a big sort of folk act. They're pretty commercial. They're not very cool. They're kind of like faux folk, not real folk. So we did their cover. And then I thought I'd put this in because it's kind of, first of all, it's in Cyrillic. And it was working with Dasha Abramovich on the identity for Garage, which I can now actually read, having spent my time here. So this was a kind of an interesting project in that Dasha spent all of her money on the opening party. So she booked Amy Winehouse to perform at the opening party, and then she had no money to do the design. So it was a kind of strange one because we'd meet in Mayfair, again in Mayfair, in the richest part of London. She'd arrive in this vehicle with these hench women with her who looked like they might kill you at any point. You'd conduct a meeting, then she'd be whisked off. So that was for the Garage. A few more sleeves, a few more album sleeves. So my passion was in doing graphic design for the music industry. I used to work at EMI. I was art director at EMI. And I worked with Sony, and I worked with Universal, Warner Brothers. All the music industry is quite small. So once you get known, you start to do jobs. So this was a picture disc for Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark, who used to be big in the 80s. and then limited edition album record sleeves, etc. Record sleeves, you don't really get any money for doing that anymore because of MP3s, digital releases. So it's more often that the band will get their friends to design the sleeves for them, and they won't get paid for it. And so the money that used to go towards this now goes towards social media or videos or whatever they're doing, which is understandable. So also working on big brands with Peter. So I was still working with Peter at this point, on and off. He'd call me in to do projects like, okay, we're doing something with Givenchy, do you want to help out? So this was just like a quick brand refresh for Givenchy, working with some weird fashion people. Blah, blah, blah. So I also do videos. I used to do videos. Let's see if this works. So it might be an opportunity to get a drink, actually. But I'm supposed to do something when I click on it. I'm supposed to play the video. Hold on. Oh, fuck. Sorry. So if I click on that, it should open this, right, okay. Ah, no music. Okay, I think you get the idea. Oops, stop. And there's I'll show you a couple more videos as well. So I was working with EMI, and when I could, I'd try and do things that were more creative. So that was like, do you want me to stop? Oh yeah, cool, that'll be good. So this was what they called a lyric video. So they do like a pre-release of the video, and they'd release it with lyrics. And most of the lyric videos are just like karaoke almost. And whilst I was at EMI, I was like, I want to do creative stuff. So let's do something that's a little bit more interesting. So with a budget of like £10 and 3 days, they're like, what can you do? So let's have a look.
Is it me? Is it you? Is it the times that we're living through? Was it hard when I had to leave? That day you seemed to change. We all need someone to guide us, someone to introduce the show. I need someone just like you, someone to let me know. I can lose it all. Is your mind still in control? There is a violence in love. Some things I'll never understand. So where the bullets missed you out, they hit me and I'm I'm not afraid to
I think you get the idea with that one. And we'll look at one more. Where do we go?
Every business needs videos.
That's not me. So again, it's a lyric video. So just slightly more interesting ways to for people to see the lyrics. And since I missed you, oh, since I last saw you, I fell down the rabbit hole. As I wonder what we'd be like, wrapped up so uptight with you. Lust will do funny things. I don't want you to go out looking so good. And you look so good. Idea with that one. Whoops. Stop. So, as you can probably tell, I was looking for a creative output to try and do things that were slightly more interesting than I'd been doing before. And music industry was kind of taking a little bit of a hit with not being getting paid, basically. So I needed some sort of visual output for doing things, expressing myself, so I started to use Instagram. At the time I was working, I'd started to work with advertising agencies as well, doing graphic design, which is pretty soul-destroying stuff. So you're working with like massive brands, selling stuff to people that don't fucking need it. So you're selling washing powder, you're selling Guinness beer, you're selling just selling shit, basically. And or even though I was getting paid reasonable money to go in and be a freelance graphic designer, you'd work from 9 a.m. till 8, 9 at night, you'd come back in the next morning, you're basically, you're not there. And I think that's what a lot of people do in London to keep up paying for your rent, etc. So I started to use Instagram as like a window for my world, and it became a way in which I could express myself freely without the thought of a client looking at what I'd done, and I could just express myself. Something which I no longer had the chance to in my work, because I wasn't doing music scene design stuff anymore. I started to get sort of recognised from Instagram. So yeah, it's a modern phone there with Instagram on it. I started to get recognised for the stuff I was doing through Instagram. So interviews with a Tate, which is like probably the foremost gallery in the UK. So people asking me what I was doing with Instagram. And weirdly, Instagram has now totally changed. So I was there kind of quite early on, and it felt like a nice community of people that you could reach out to people in San Francisco, in wherever in the world. And it felt like a creative exploration of like new things that you could do. So it felt kind of exciting. It's no longer like that. You basically get ads for stuff. Like, you know, I got an advert for a funeral director the other day. So it's changed. So I decided that it was kind of time for a change. And Boyd, so what happened with me on Instagram was that I'd got to like 3,000 followers, and I thought that was quite good. And then somebody at Instagram started to like my stuff, and I think they have meetings where they suggest users. So they say when someone joins Instagram, there'll be a list of people that you might want to follow. So I got an email one night, sort of midnight, that said, "You have become a suggested user." So as soon as that happened, you'd get like 100 new followers every time you look at your phone. So it went from 3,000 followers to 30,000 followers in 2 weeks, which was kind of crazy. So you'd gone from this being something that you were really quite passionate about and was very close to your heart, and you'd built this community, to then becoming like public property, to like some American kid saying that I was gay for taking a picture of a rose. Like, you become like this public thing. So it Instagram kind of changed, but it kind of gave me the insight and the thought that I could go to anywhere in the world and do something, and it felt like with my design work I needed to do that. So one of my friends at the time was working designing a magazine called Nini Aminga in Rwanda in East Africa. So they needed someone to go there and live in country, and their job would be to mentor a local graphic designer to try and teach them how, because they've got no official education there, teach them how to become a graphic designer and how to design a magazine. So I decided that I should go and live in Rwanda, which was a pretty big step at the time, because I was living with my girlfriend, we were obviously together, and it was like, I'm going to go and do this thing. And she knew that I wasn't happy with my work, so it took a lot of trust from her to go there, and we did split up. So I moved to Rwanda, which was obviously totally different. And this is the design work that I was doing there. So it was aimed at, so the ethos of the magazine is that it's a charity to help women, girls and women. And if you help the girls and women, so Nini Aminga means the first girl at the top of the hill. So it's like an aspirational magazine for young women. The fact that even there's women on bikes was like an amazing thing in Rwandan culture. Women shouldn't be riding bikes. That's like almost a taboo. So they were breaking boundaries and showing women that you can do anything. So that was the focus. And the idea was women look after themselves, then their culture will look after them. So the actual design work, I mean, it is what it is. And whilst I was in Rwanda, I'd also got another thought that I wanted to start doing more photography. So buoyed by the fact that I was doing okay on Instagram and the fact that I was very passionate about photography, and all my previous work, I tried to include all photography in my work, be it the music scene design and stuff. So I started to take walks around Rwanda and document that. So meeting people and taking their photographs and creating a visual diary of my time. The Rwandan story is pretty unique. So during the genocide, 1 million people were killed in 100 days in a small country in East Africa. So there's not a day that goes by that you don't sort of come across someone that hasn't been affected by that. Just for an example, I was stood in the kitchen where I was working, and I was showing the cleaner my scars on my legs, and I was saying, "Oh yeah, I fell off my bike and I've got another scar there." And she said, "I've got a scar there where someone put a machete into the top of my head." So that's the kind of day-to-day, everyone's affected by the genocide in Rwanda. And my junior designer on the first day there, we were just talking and introducing ourselves, having lunch, and he said, "Yeah, my mum was killed, my dad was killed, and my brother was killed." So it's a very strange place. But also people are totally open. So they're interested because I was white and different, and they wanted to know me and they wanted to talk to me. So it made it very easy to take photographs of people. So they would be a little wary of cameras. There's stories about the camera stealing your soul, taking it away from you. So people are wary of it, but I tried to be charming and I tried to be honest and say what I was doing. And I'd often return with a print to give to them as in return for them letting me take their photographs. So yeah, this is just walking around the townships. It's pretty backward compared to London, and people live in fairly simple conditions. This is on the border of Congo, so just yeah, Congo is basically at war constantly, and this is a natural methane lake. So on this lake, there's a power station powered by methane, and I think it's the only methane lake in the world. And there are stories of the methane exploding and whole villages being killed and falling into the water. So you're on the border of Congo here, so it's very weird. kind of nationalistic. You get used to men with AK-47 guns just standing on corners of streets. Yeah. So, yeah, whilst I was in Rwanda, I fell in love with a woman, a new woman, and she's an art photographer from New Zealand, and she's somebody that I greatly admired. I'll just scroll through my photographs. She's one that I greatly admired, and she inspired me to push my work more as a photographer. So we used to hang around together, talk about photography, talk about what she was going to do, and I think given the heightened sensations in Rwanda, it kind of elevated our sensation together. So, yeah, when my work was over, so I spent eight months in Rwanda, living there and working there. And when it was over, she invited me. She was doing an art residency, very much like I'm doing here, in a place called Whanganui, which is in New Zealand. And she said, why don't you come? Why don't you come and spend that time with me in New Zealand? So I booked the tickets. I spent the £700 on return tickets to New Zealand, and I was very excited to go. I worked in advertising agencies leading up to that to earn enough money to go. And then 2 weeks before I was due to fly out, she broke up with me. So, and she said, don't come to New Zealand. You shouldn't come. You definitely don't come. So I decided to go anyway. Not to see her, but I decided to rent a camper van for 2 months and drive from the top of the island to the bottom and back up again. So I was nearly in Antarctic when I got to the bottom and I drove back up again. And yeah, New Zealand, there you go. And whilst I was there on my own in a van, I decided that I should take photographs and do a project. So I started to think about something called the human interface of New Zealand. So New Zealand is quite a big country, but there's not many people there. So you see more sheep than you do people. And there aren't many signs of humans. So I started to think about the interzone between land and me and where humans have come into interaction with that. So here's a series called, what was it called again? The human interface of New Zealand. So these are the project. These are the photographs from my 2 months alone in a van traveling around New Zealand, stopping off at various pubs and camping places along the way. So it was a pretty hard time in that van on my own on the other side of the world, but it allowed me quite a lot of time to think about what I was doing, and I realized that basically I want to be a photographer. So I started to take it more seriously, and yeah, this is a guest house. I feel that actually represents my ex from New Zealand, that woman. So I flew back to London, and the UK was kind of engulfed in this weird refugee crisis where in Calais in France, which is just across the water from us, refugees were gathering to come to our country, and our press was kind of filled with horrible stories about these barbaric people coming to take your jobs or get benefits, or like basically they're not real humans, and that's the way they were being treated in the media. So I thought, I want to go to Calais for myself and see what's going on there and try and understand these people. So I went to Calais and tried to understand, without any sort of media agenda or being paid, what was going on. And then my aim was to relate that back to people in the UK. So these are the photographs from Calais. You sit and watch the media and you think, I've got to do something, what can I do? And the only thing I could possibly do was to make other people understand that the people in Calais were just like me or just like you. So I went there and I met people, and most of them asked me to have coffee with them and asked why they're not allowed into the UK and asked me to take them back to the UK with me in my car. And that's kind of tricky because there's no real reason why you shouldn't be able to do that, but just the fact they haven't got a passport. So it felt like a pretty desperate situation for these people. And there was churches set up, there were barbers set up. So it was a whole community in Calais. And there was another camp in Dunkirk, which is very close to Calais, about 10 miles away. And people were just living in mud. So there was no real infrastructure set up. They were living amongst trees. And this was at that camp. And it felt so bad to even point a camera at someone that I couldn't point a camera at someone. So this image basically sums up how desperate that situation was. This baby face down in the mud. Yeah. There we go. So I'm a bit lost where I am. So with this project, I've done some Instagram takeovers. So the Photographers Gallery in London allowed me to take over their feed. It's quite a big institution in London. And I put all these images out on that feed. So it felt like people were seeing the images and understanding a little more these people's crisis. I'll just tell you about this image. So these women, there weren't many women in the camp, and most of the women were probably hiding in their shelters, but these women made a special effort to follow me around the camp, and they had this white sheet with them, which you can see behind there, and they wanted me to take a photograph, which was kind of weird. And they wanted me to take a photograph so they could get a fake passport made. So they had this white backdrop, and they wear a hijab. So with their passport, they need one with a hijab and one without. So we conducted a photo shoot in the camp as if it was like a passport photo. And then later that night, when I was on the ferry, I emailed them these photographs, and they added me on Facebook. And hopefully they made, I think, actually, this is Ruta, and I think she made it to Holland. I still follow her. So it was a pretty desperate situation there, but there were stories of hope. So my work was starting to get a bit more recognition. People were sort of realizing that I was a photographer, it became real that I was a photographer by sort of self-fulfilled prophecy, by doing it, basically. I decided to do it, and I was doing it. So I started to get commissions from magazines. So because of my time in Rwanda, someone had heard about that, and they wanted to do a story about Amasunzu, which is a sort of traditional Rwandan haircut. Let's show you what it looks like. So this guy is called Wamazina Harbi, and he's written many novels in which he calls himself the Street Prince. And he wasn't actually in Rwanda during the genocide, so I think he's got a kind of unique personality. He's not repressed. He dares to say what he wants to say, and he dares express himself with Rwandan culture. So he wears the haircut, the Amasunzu haircut, which is kind of steeped in Rwandan culture. So with these jobs, a lot what I'm finding out now as well, a lot gets lost in translation. So when I arrived in Rwanda, in Kigali, in the capital city, I get driven by my taxi man to this place where these people are meeting me. And they're all dressed in what they think is traditional African outfits, like almost like I was a colonial person coming to see them in Africa, which was really fucking bizarre. And then I've got to sit with them and listen to all their stories about why they're doing this. And I actually had to watch this man bite a chicken's head off, which was just fucking totally bizarre. But what I wanted to do was to get them in normal clothing, like normal Western clothing that they'd wear every day. So we don't look upon them as like African people. We just look at them as people. So it took a while, but I got them to sort of relax. And we went to the barbers with Wamazina, and we had his hair cut. We had his haircut done. And also a woman called Janet, who's 18. She wears this amazingly extreme haircut, but she only wears it when she's not at work. So she wears a wig most of the time, and she works for a Muslim family as a nanny. So not many people know that she wears this hair. So as we're walking down the street and she's got this hair, kids are like, fucking unbelievable. She looks so striking. So this was for a magazine called Jocks and Nerds. So they paid for me to go to Rwanda, like a small amount of money. I didn't earn much money from doing this job, but it was pretty amazing. And there she is. And I knew through my experience that there was going to be amazing light and there's going to be fantastic backdrops. So this is just walking around the streets of Kigali. So in Kigali, phone companies will say to people, would you like your house painted? And they say yes. So they paint it with the brand colors of a phone company, and they don't pay the person. They just, their house has got like Airtel or Vodafone written on the side of it. So I knew there was going to be really bright colors. Or like this one is in front of a beer advert. So I knew that would happen. So with most of my photographic trips, they're kind of unplanned, but I've kind of got an idea of what might happen. Yeah. So this is in Bosnia. So this is a project that I did last year. A friend of mine was going to Bosnia, and there's this walk. So in Bosnia as well, there's a genocide. So there's a bit of a theme running through my work. So it seemed like an interesting project that she was doing. The people that survived the genocide in Bosnia make a walk between Tuzla and Srebrenica. It's 70 kilometers, I think, and it reenacts the walk that the actual refugees made to the safety, what they thought was going to be safety of the UN base in Srebrenica. Unfortunately, the UN withdrew from that base, and thousands of people were killed, thousands of men and boys were killed, and women were raped. So we followed the walk, and we also traveled around Bosnia looking at the effects of the genocide. And this project's called The UN Left. So you can see people would wear... So this genocide was against Muslims. I'm starting to realize that there's a weird mix, and this includes this country too. There's a weird mix between religion, war, army, and actually in this country, science, which is kind of strange. So it was a particularly hot, grueling time in Bosnia. So these guys are just cooling down. But I couldn't help make the connection between men being executed with machine guns and the water cannon in this image. Whoops. So this is in Srebrenica itself. So this guy is the mayor of Srebrenica. So you'd think with all these atrocities, people would learn from these mistakes and things would change. But currently in Bosnia, they're trying to separate their schools between Muslims and Catholics. And this is the mayor of Srebrenica, and he denies that a genocide happened. So nothing's really changing. It's very difficult circumstance for everybody there. And I actually bumped into him in a cafe, which was really weird. And so the main reason for this walk is that every year more people are being identified by their DNA. So they bury more people every year. So there's a graveyard in Srebrenica, and there's open graves, and there's people being buried. So there's relatives sat next to their graves. There's people interviewing them. It's crazy. And there's 20,000 people in this graveyard, and it was really hot. So they're giving out aid. They're giving out water. Yeah, you can see the extent of this. And just beyond these people, these are grieving mothers, sisters, etc. And these green things are the coffins that get buried. This is a woman called Fatima, and Fatima runs an Airbnb in Srebrenica. So she was my host. And I think this is kind of like the start of a style. So with my Instagram feed, it's like colors. So people will expect some colors from me. I'm kind of, even in dark circumstances, I'm sort of attracted to weird color combinations. So this is like unretouched. And it also talks about a cause, I guess. This is where 800 people were killed in a theater, in a cinema. So they lined, you can see the bullet holes in the wall. This was a particularly dark place to be. So where the projector would go, they fired machine gun bullets and bombs at the people that were lined up in this place. It was fucking weird. This is on the edge of an aluminium. So there's an aluminium factory, and they let the water just run into this lake. So it's naturally red, which is kind of bizarre in itself. But this is a place where men and boys were taken, and they were lined up, and they were executed, and they fell into the water. So there's bodies at the bottom of that lake. Yeah, this is a nightclub. It's not used anymore. So this is in Sarajevo, and it's at the top of the bobsleigh track. So in 1984, there was the Olympics in Sarajevo, and they have mountains. So it was the Winter Olympics, and the mountains were used for like a stronghold to mortar the city, to bomb Sarajevo. So this place is now like totally bombed out with machine gun bullets. So there's like six horses living in the bobsleigh changing room. And that's at the top of the ski jump. So there's actually an ex-UN base on the right-hand side here, where the UN were based trying to make peace, I guess. Yeah. I started to get recognized as doing, I don't know, socially motivated projects. So UNICEF and Polaroid asked me to go back to Dunkirk, to the refugee camps, and use. So I'm a passionate collector of Polaroid cameras. So I've got like 20 or 30 old Polaroid cameras. And I'd done projects with Polaroid in the past. So they asked me to go back to the refugee camp in Dunkirk. And they were going to make a book with several artists who were doing similar things. So I went back to Dunkirk, and I took Polaroids of the people that were in the refugee camp. So the refugee camp became the first internationally recognized refugee camp, I think, in Western Europe. And the security was actually really difficult to get in. So in Calais, you could just walk in. It was on the beaches. It was just there. In Dunkirk, it was like they're police. So I had to pretend to be from a Swedish charity to gain access. So with some of the projects I do, it's like you've got to take chances to get in to these places. But as soon as I'm in there, I'm honest with the people and tell them what the reason I'm doing things. Whilst I'm in London, I've got to have a project that keeps me going at the same time as like all these planning these travelling trips to do self-interested projects. So this is a project called Welcome to Britain. So Muslims are being represented in the UK as, again, kind of nasty, really troublemaking people. And there is obviously a certain sect of Muslims who are attacking Western society. But the majority of people, Muslim people, are very friendly, normal people. So my idea was to meet local Muslim people and take portraits of these people in my environment, in my local environment, to try and understand. And I was a little bit wary of this project because I think people can be quite closed, but I was surprised how open people were. So this is a mosque which used to be a Jewish temple, and this is a guy called Egg. Egg painted his name on the top of his mosque in the middle of London. He's quite a character. He's also been he's been in prison for murder, so he's quite an interesting chap. I kind of attract those sort of people. Again, in a mosque. This is like 500 meters from my house. So I was trying to just, this is a project that keeps me, this is an ongoing project, so I try and meet local Muslim people to try and build some sort of understanding for myself. This guy makes clothing, moderate clothing for Muslims. So I've started to build commercial projects. So I work with Vice magazine now and again. So they commissioned me to do a project about, what did they commission me? Urban regeneration or something. So you can kind of see a correlation between the styles of the work, hopefully. But this just sort of shows you that you can actually make money by doing sort of artistic photography, I guess. So these guys, I've got a World War II bunker in South London, and they grow cress, which they sell to supermarkets. It's kind of weird. They grow cress, like, and lettuce, and like, but underground, and they sell it to supermarkets and various places. This is an art installation at Somerset House. So this is, again, a project for Vice magazine. So I've started to pick up work from there. So now we're in Ukraine. So I reached out to... So I also work with a hair magazine called Infringe, who contract me to do certain things. I'll talk about that in a minute. So my time in Ukraine started in Slavutich. So I booked my flight, and it just so happened that it coincided with the anniversary of the Chernobyl disaster. So I was kind of drawn into Chernobyl and Slavutich as like something that was darkly interesting to me. So on the day that I arrived in Kiev, which was the 25th, I took a taxi straight to Slavutich to watch the candlelit vigil that happens every year for them to remember the people that are affected by that accident. So I went straight there, and yeah, I wanted to meet people, liquidators. So this is a woman that lives in Slavutich, and she lived in Pripyat at the time of the accident, and she was 4 months pregnant with Jay. Jay is standing in the background there, and Jay's been deeply affected by that, his health. So he's got liver problems. And then I went on to meet liquidators at the museum in Slavutich and took portraits of all those people. So you guys probably know, but the clock is stopped at the time when the accident happened, and there's obviously a picture of the reactor. I kind of wanted them to look like Soviet promotion posters, like almost like constructivist, aspirational, atomic, idyllic people. So these guys were very proud of their work. I also interviewed them about what they did there, which was kind of interesting too. And this woman is the head of the Veterans Society. So she runs the liquidators and tells them what they can and can't do, or that group that I met. And then I also went to people's homes. So this guy is totally different. So he had a very disturbing story about, he went into hospital, there was 12 people, only 4 people came out. He escaped, and then he was also put into prison for telling the truth about what happened during that time. So this interview was about 20 minutes before we started to take photographs. So we were crying, and we drank rum to help the story, and Yeah, and that's him with his cat. So another little thing about this story. So this guy was Soviet weightlifting champion when he was 18, and he's now 60, having survived Chernobyl. So when I take photographs of people, I try and make connections with people, and that mostly comes naturally. So I'll just speak to someone and engage them with it with my eyes. I'll talk to them, try and be honest about it. So I thought that it would be a good idea to try and lift these weights. So he just lifted 20 times very easily, 40 kilograms. He's like 65, I'm 39. I thought I'll be able to do that. I couldn't lift it at all. This guy's fucking strong. So he said that he survived because he was an athlete. This guy actually went into photograph in Chernobyl to document what was happening there. So this is the main reason for my project of coming to Ukraine, which is a very strange reason to come. So as I mentioned, I work with a hair magazine called Infringe, and I'd spoken to Infringe about, I've always wanted to work with them, and we talked about doing some work in the Calais, in the refugee camp in Calais, because there was many barbers set up in Calais. So I was like, I'll go to Calais, we'll take photographs of barbers, we'll put that in your magazine, that'll be kind of interesting. So the refugee camp shut in Calais, so I was unable to do that, but I was constantly thinking of ways that I could work with Infringe and travel and do something interesting and sort of politically interesting. So I came up with the idea of Velosa hair project, hair extensions. So I wanted people in the West to realize where their hair extensions came from, so they'd got some sort of connection with the ridiculous thing they're doing by doing these hair extensions in the pursuit of beauty. So I started to reach out to fixers. So fixers are people that make things happen in the Ukraine. So Lena helped me out with fixers, and we tried to line up these people that cut their hair. It turns out it's not that easy. So even though so I spoke to people here when I first came, and I was like, yeah, it's a thing here, isn't it? It's a thing. And they were like, we've not seen anything. So I started to see all these adverts. They're all over the place. they're all over the place. So my idea was to get portraits of women that sell their hair. So the portraits will be in their environment, in their house, and it would be a before and after picture. So before they cut the hair and after they've cut the hair. So it's going to be quite a dramatic transition, and also to get them in their environment so you can feel where they really come from. And it's proved to be very difficult. So I went to Kharkiv to photograph some stuff, some architecture stuff, for a friend who's doing a book about architecture in Kharkiv. But whilst I was there, I went to a hair extension salon through various ways of communication and Google Translate. This is a photograph of hair extensions. And this is the shop in a very strange department shopping center in Kharkiv, in the outskirts of Kharkiv, where I saw two men having a fight after I'd done these photographs. And this is a woman called Anna, who told me that for a job she teaches sport. I'm not sure whether she does. This kind of describes the pursuit of beauty. So she's had the hair extensions put in, so she kindly let me take photographs of her. And this describes the sort of the side of beauty that I'm trying to expose, which I find slightly weird. So there she is. So that kind of concludes where I'm at with my project, and gives you a broad idea of where I've come from and what I'm trying to do with my work. So yeah. Спасибо.
Hi, thank you for the lecture. I'll ask some awfully simple questions, like, do you have a favorite photographer? And if you do, what do you think of influence of this person on your style? Like, yeah, just if you do. And secondly, could you tell me what camera do you use? What which lens? And maybe which programs do you use for working with photos?
Ah, so probably my favorite photographer is a guy called Martin Parr. He's a very sort of typically English photographer who looks at the minutiae of life that makes people British. He did various projects where he'd go into people's houses in the 80s and photograph their interiors and also how they dressed. So his style is like almost kitsch, but I think there's a lot of truth in what he does. He tries to either highlight how ridiculous people are by looking at, for example, Russian oligarchs and photograph them, or he tries to relate people, and I hope there's some essence of that in what I do. So he's my favorite photographer. And then in terms of the equipment that I use, so all my Instagram photographs are taken on my phone, because it's easy and there's no processing that's involved. And when I started doing Instagram, it was my only aim was to not filter anything. Don't filter it, don't put hashtags, don't use sex, don't use dogs, like to sell yourself, just try and do things that are kind of interesting and don't use any filters. That was my thing that I did because everybody else was using filters. So it was like, I kind of had a mission. How could I make myself look different? And the way to make myself look different was by not doing all this filter shit. So that's what I use for my Instagram. For my, what I call my sort of proper photography, where I've got like a proper camera, I've got a Canon 5D Mark II. And I use a 24-70 lens. And then I will put that into Lightroom, Adobe Lightroom, and then I'll do sort of minimal. I try and keep my images as true to how they looked. Sometimes I'll push the color a little bit to make it look a little bit more accentuated, but I try and make it look as natural and as real as possible. Before I came here, I reached out to Fuji, who lent me this amazing medium format digital camera. So they've just given me a camera for a month, which is really nice of them. And the photographs on that are like amazing. So that's the equipment. I'd probably say that I don't really like to use too much equipment or too much like programs, because you can end up making all your images look like everybody else's images, because you can just like put a preset and make it look like film. I try and keep it like, although having said that, I've done a lot of processing on this image. Let's go back to this one. So yeah, spasiba. Any more questions? Yet. Okay, thank you.
Дякуємо дуже за увагу.